This is an MPB Think Radio podcast. To hear previous shows, visit mpbonline.org or download the MPB Public Radio app to listen on your iPhone or Android phone on demand.
Okie dokie, folks. Welcome back. Horticulturist Felder rushing here, and we're going to be talking about gardening, all things gardening. If it's garden related, you know, anybody's been listening to this program for the past, I don't know, Java, how long have we been doing this? 15, 20 years? Something, who knows?
Well, you have been doing it for a long time. I've been here for 5 years. You were here before I got here, and I believe you were here before my predecessor got here. So you tell me.
Well, as a matter of fact, this month starts my, let me see, I started in, this will be my 20th year on NPR. How about that?
I started
as soon as I retired from university, and I did that when I was 50 because I had a fellow appointment. I immediately left commercial radio and came over to NPR. I think it was one of the first talk programs that we had here at MPB. So I just did 20 years ago this month. How about that?
Congratulations, man.
Thank you. And over the years, even the long time you've been my esteemed producer, you know I don't know it all, and I'm okay with that.
And like I tell you all the time, that's what makes you special, man. A lot of people get on the microphone and flub for the sake of not looking bad. But, I mean, hey, I don't know is a proper phrase, and it's okay.
Yeah, well, you know, as a professional, I mean, I'm a horticulturist and supposed to be a garden expert, written all these books and stuff, but a lot of people expect experts to know it all. The problem is, when an expert knows it all, he's going to say something, he or she's going to say something sooner or later that's just not right. And everybody else, all the other experts say, well, that person's an idiot. Well, I'm not an idiot. I'm ignorant. Ignorant means you just don't know yet. Stupid is when you can't admit it. But anyway, I feel like that I can help folks on most things that are related to gardening. That's what we're here for. MPB brings these live local produced programs for folks who have questions about all sorts of life experiences. And as a matter of fact, we're going to talk after the break about, you know, me wanting to join one next week on a medical matter. But meanwhile, how you and yours doing, Java? Doing all right?
Yeah, man, we're doing all right. I keep telling people, if you can believe it, we're at the end of July. In a couple weeks, the kids will be going back to school. And I just had the thought of the seeds in the cup. I know that's one of like the early science experiments that they do at the school to watch the seeds sprout open.
Yeah. And, how'd that do?
What'd you say?
How did it do?
Oh, it always does fine. It's just that wonder of seeing the green come out of usually the white or the brown seed that's always, you know, spectacular for the kids.
Well, I'm looking forward to getting back in a month or so. I'll be back in the lawn garden, and it's going to be interesting to see how it's done over the past 2 months or so. It'll be 3 months at the time with nobody watering. Just whatever falls from the sky. And, you know, it can go weeks between whatever falls from the sky. So, you know, it'll be a testament to whether over the past several decades, me looking for really tough plants that will tolerate our weather, it'll be a testament to see how well it does. And, of course, we'll report on that. Speaking of reporting, Java, I just got back last night from a once-in-every-10-year event. I think I mentioned it earlier, a month or so ago, but Europe has this big flower show called Floriade. Floriade is every 10 years, and it's where the top horticulturists from the Netherlands and France and Spain and Saudi Arabia and China and Germany, they all get together and they put on this incredible demonstration of flowers and designs from around the world. This is my third one to go to, and I spent a lot of time 8.2 miles, as a matter of fact, walking up and down, looking at stuff and taking pictures. And I got some cheesy ideas that I'm going to share with folks on a blog and on the Mississippi Gardening Facebook probably a little bit later this afternoon. But I would like to remind folks, it's a call-in program. It's live. It's toll-free. If you don't know something, you know, maybe we can work it out. Give us a call toll-free, 1-877-MPB-RING. pretty straightforward, folks, here at MPB.
Now, at this Floriade, did you see any bottle trees or tire planters?
Well, as a matter of fact, a lot of stuff. Well, the first thing I want to mention, the most incredible flower borders, the big flowing perennial borders that are head high and everywhere, in every display, all over the place, were full of plants that Mississippians call weeds. I'm talking about goldenrod and liatris and phlox, so many of our native Mississippi wildflowers, and vines like trumpet creeper. These plants are commonly used in European and Asian gardens because they're beautiful plants, and we often overlook them because we'd rather plant something from somewhere else. So one thing Floriade has shown me is that when it comes to gardening, it is a global thing. People all over the world share plants according to the climate, and almost all of them use a majority of the plants that bloom in the summertime and the fall are from Mississippi. And that's kind of interesting to find out. I did see there was a house that was made out of, one of the walls was made out of glass. It was kind of, it looked like just a whole bunch of bottles. I went inside, looked out. It was incredible indoors, the light coming through all these, every color of the rainbow, and they were just bottles filled with colored water. And what they had done is they put different kind of flowers and foliage in water and let those colors infuse the water. So it was just a kaleidoscope of colors coming in through this glass wall of just jars filled with colored water and different colored flowers in them.
That sounds neat right there, yeah, letting the water just get infused. That I bet you that looks nice.
As a matter of fact, I can send that picture to use with our podcast today. But one other thing is they had a really interesting urban garden made, all the walls and the sculptures and the seating and the water, everything was made out of recycled rubble from cities. And in the concrete rubble wall in between the pavers, they had Coca-Cola bottles stuck head down. And I know they're Coca-Cola bottles because they're the only ones that are that color and that thick. But they had looked like rivers of Coca-Cola bottles flowing through the paving. So I thought, does that count as a bottle tree?
Yeah, something's close. It's close enough.
There you go. Well, we can talk about that other kind of stuff. But meanwhile, we're here to chat with people about what's going on in your garden. Give us a call, toll-free 1-877-MPB-RING. We're going to start out over in Louisiana. Dinah, how are you this morning?
I'm okay, and yourself?
Good. Hello?
Yes, hello.
Howdy. We're on MPB. What's up today?
Yes, I have a pear tree. It's a Japanese pear tree, and it's like, I don't know, maybe 12 years old. And it does have pears on it, but I can't remember from the previous times exactly when they're ripe. Is that more of a fall thing?
No, it really depends on the variety. There are some pears and apples and others that ripen earlier than others. Unfortunately, without knowing what variety is and the conditions grown under, you really can't tell. So all I can suggest is every now and then just squeeze one, and it starts feeling a little bit squeezy. Take a bite out of it, and if it feels like it's starting to sweeten up, then you need to start thinking about beating the squirrels and the birds to it. But there's nobody can predict exactly when it's going to happen, depending on the weather and the variety. So you're just going to have to feel it, squeeze it, smell it maybe, then take a bite.
Definitely. Thank you.
Okay. Appreciate your call.
Okay.
You know, Java, there's different kind of fruits. I don't remember if pears are climacteric. Let me see. I'm going to keep pears.
Now, Felder, you just came up with another T-shirt, right?
What's that?
You said squeeze it, smell it, and take a bite.
There you go. Yeah. If it smells okay and it feels okay, then take a bite out of it. I wouldn't do it the other way around.
Oh, no. Uh-uh.
Yeah. Yeah, but some fruits, when you pick them off the when you take them off the tree or off the vine, they continue to ripen. Some won't. Strawberries, for example. As soon as you pick those, they start going down real quick. Tomatoes, you can pick them when they're a little bit on the green side, when they start to show color, and they'll go ahead and ripen off the vine. I don't remember if pears are that way or not, but when we come up in our break, I've got it called up, but I can't talk and read at the same time. But so I tell you what, while I look that up, let's take a real quick break. And when we come back, I want to address something that just came up in Mississippi. It's a potentially serious, it's certainly a serious worry, but how serious it's going to actually be, we don't know yet. But when we come back from the break, I want to address a brand new breaking event in Mississippi that relates directly to gardeners. I'm horticulturist Felder Rushing. I'm overseas right now. Just got back from Floriade, the world's largest European flower show. And we're going to come back and talk about gardening of any sort, any description. Give us a call again. We'll give the numbers right after this. But me and Job and the other folks in MPB, we welcome you to our program. And we'll be right back after this.
Hi, I'm Dr. Jimmy Stewart, Professor of Internal Medicine and Pediatrics at the University of Mississippi Medical Center. On the original Southern Remedy, we answer questions about all aspects of your health and share some of the latest medical information in the news. You can listen to the show on Wednesdays at 11 on MPB Think Radio, or you can subscribe to the podcast by searching for Southern Remedy on your preferred podcasting app.
I'm gonna eat some worms. Long, thin, slimy ones. Short, fat, juicy ones. Itsy, bitsy, fuzzy, wuzzy worms. Down goes the first one. Down goes the second one. Oh, how they wiggle and squirm. Long, thin, slimy ones. Short, fat, juicy ones. Itsy, bitsy, fuzzy, wuzzy worms.
All right. This is a, one of those kind of oddball things where people talk about, I'm going to eat some worms and eating dirt and all like that. But did you get that email I sent you about this thing called melioidosis?
Yeah, I got it, and I was kind of intrigued because this is...
It's breaking news.
Yeah.
In matter of fact, I'd like to, if I could, check in with the medical folks on, is it Medical Matters?
Oh, Southern Remedy.
Yeah, Southern Remedy, because they're on top of things. But apparently there's a bacteria that some people, when they go to tropical countries, they work with farmers and gardeners, there's a bacteria in the soil that can make some people sick. It gives them aches and chills and headaches and fevers. And in some cases, if you got, you know, if you comprised immunity, it can actually be fatal. Well, it's just been discovered for the very first time in the United States. It was found in two places on the Mississippi Gulf Coast. So we're first in something.
No.
I'm not trying to go there. But anyway, it was just discovered, was diagnosed. And I'm going to get more information about it, but I've already started getting emails about it. People in Mississippi Gardening Facebook have been asking about it. So in a nutshell, I'd like to point out melioidosis is a rare disease, and it's caused by soil-borne bacteria, just discovered for the first time in Mississippi. It's usually not fatal, but the Mississippi State
epidemiologist.
Yeah. Anyway, Paul Byers, I met Paul some years ago. He says that because it being identified in Mississippi, people at high risk for infection living on the Gulf Coast should take recommended precautions. And basically what that means is if you've got if you're at high risk of severe infection, don't play in the muddy water. Avoid contact with soil, especially after heavy rains. Protect open wounds with gloves. And wear waterproof boots if you're gardening and yard work, and it's really wet out there. But basically says wear gloves. He didn't say don't chew your fingernails, but the bottom line is this is a soil-borne bacteria. It's just been discovered. It's extremely rare, but it's of concern. And so we're going to get a little bit more information about that and bring it to you next week or during Southern Remedy. Is that Wednesday?
Yeah, the original Southern Remedies Wednesday at 11 a.m.
Okay, well, you're the producer for that, though, aren't you?
No, that's Kevin Farrell. So I'm gonna talk with him, and I believe we can work something out.
Yeah. If you could get Paul Burns on there or something like that, I think it's worth noting, because a lot of people are going to be freaked out because, you know, I'm not a protected gardener. I'm not wearing gloves, and I get cuts and scrapes and stuff like that. And I'm just curious about it. We need to find out. We need to stay on top of this. So that's sort of a cutting edge thing that we try to bring to folks here at MPB. So if you have some questions about it, give me a call, but I'm going to have a full report next week. Meanwhile, let's talk to a fellow named Fletch, calling from Mississippi. Fletch, where are you calling from, man?
Today I'm actually in Flowood.
Flowood, okay. What's going on there?
But all good. Your song reminded me that one of Skip of Dodd's entrepreneurial options or jobs back in the NOLA 70s days was growing night crawlers.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I remember you and Skipper Dodd, and my mother's probably involved in that somewhere. You know what? Worms are actually edible. They're high protein and low cholesterol, believe it or not. But what a weird thing, man. So
yeah, their excrement, I think, is just too high of a ratio versus the that protein.
Yeah, well, you're supposed to run them through some moist cornmeal first to purge them, but we're not going to get into all that. They do have an earthworm cooking contest in California every year, but they always run some moist cornmeal through the worms first. But anyway, what else you got?
We cook ours on the sidewalk, I guess. All right, so two questions. One, on your Coke bottle walkway,
yeah.
I take it they didn't have names of towns on it where you could see it?
You know, now this is really strange. I'm going to go back and look at the pictures because I went through literally 3 days of flower show in one day, and I didn't really. But I'm going to go back and look at the pictures. That's because it might be one from Mississippi.
It'd be neat if it were European or American.
Yeah.
Main reason I called was, we've got some pretty healthy hydrangeas in our courtyard. We continually have a pretty healthy number of mosquitoes, regardless of what we do. Are they probably harboring that big canopy of hydrangeas? Are they harboring the mosquitoes?
Well, adult mosquitoes, you know, they take refuge in the daytime in foliage. You know, so if you've got a bunch of shrubs and all, you know, that's not where they don't live there, but they'll stay there where it's cooler and moisture during the daytime. And I would imagine hydrangeas, because they have big leaves, they probably give off a good bit of moisture and keeps them cool. So, you know, mosquitoes hang out in the daytime in dense foliage, no question.
Any suggestions on mitigating that?
No. Wear long sleeves, put on stuff, personal protection, because there's nothing that's going to effectively, and there's a lot of companies out there that sell mosquito control, and they can work to some extent for a little while, but mosquitoes can come from 3 blocks away, and the first breeze
sure.
comes along, and you'd have to kill virtually everything out there to fully get rid of them. So it boils down to personal protection and a fan.
Good deal. Thanks, sir. Take care.
All right, man. Good to hear from you. Yeah, that's a good question. I'm going to have to go back and look at these pictures of these beer bottles to see if they have, Coca-Cola bottles on the bottom of them. At least the old ones used to have what state they were made in. I've seen an entire collection of all 50 states of Coca-Cola bottles. But anyway, Tom is calling from on the road. Tom, where are you, man?
I'm heading south to do gopher tortoise and Florida harvest man surveys, but wanted to talk to you about something you like, which is my first seasonal observation of blooming solidago here, the goldenrods.
Yeah.
I noticed this in West Jackson yesterday. I know they like it in Europe, so there you have it. One more thing. I think Java learned a new word yesterday. I'm going to see if he remembers it and if you know it. In your heat in Britain last week, did you see squirrels spluting?
No. Squirrels, what?
Spluting. Ask Java.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. This is, hey, Tom Mann, correct?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, spluting, Felder, is if you ever seen like a dog and they lay flat out with their hind legs kind of open, getting cool. That's what you call spluting.
I've seen that. I've done that a time or two myself, but never on an oak tree limb.
Yeah, well, that and sidewalks, things like that. There's pictures all over Texas, and I see them here as well, of squirrels and chipmunks on our back porch spluting. So
yeah,
there you have it.
Let me ask you this while I got you online, because you grow a lot of kind of fruits. How do these blueberries do with the – is that new fruit fly? Is it causing still causing problems?
I did not see much of it this year because it was hot and dry. So that sterilizes the male fruit flies above 90. So we had no issue with that. Had a great blueberry year, but the figs and the pears and about everything else is suffering from too many non-spluting squirrels and deer.
Well, let me ask you this.
And raccoons.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, not much you can do about that except use bird netting and tie it around the bottom of your shrubs and hope that that works. Let me ask you this, Tom. I had a call earlier. A woman wanted to know how to tell if her. She said Japanese pear. I'm assuming it's an Asian type pear. They are climacteric. They'll ripen off the tree.
Okay. The Chinese pears, I think not. European pears, yes.
Okay.
And integrates between them, I can't say, but in general, you want to pick the Asian pears when they're ripe, and you want to on the tree, and you want to, and you can pick the Europeans a little bit early, let them sit on the counter and ripen in general.
Yeah, but the only way you can tell is feel them, smell them, bite them.
Yeah, the color shift if it's European pear and it's large enough late in the season, pick and let it sit there for a few days to a week, and the color shifts. If the seeds are black. When you cut it, if the seeds aren't black, it wasn't ripe enough.
Yeah,
you need dark seed, dark brown, black, whatever.
Well, that would work on the ones from China too, wouldn't they? So you
well,
cut into one.
I don't.
The,
I just. I don't think they don't do as well once you've picked them. It's just,
yeah, gotcha.
I think.
All righty, man. Well, hands on the wheel. Let us know how things are going when you get down on the coast.
No kidding. I'm not that far. I won't go that far down. But again, we're looking for tortoises and Florida harvester ants, for those that haven't heard of those.
Yeah, well, I think you told me one time you can tell where the gopher tortoises are by the harvester ants.
The range is large overlap here, not telling, but where you find both do well. Because in general, where you find both, you're missing fire ants.
Yeah.
You don't have as many fire ants, so they both reproduce well. So that's it.
All right, Tom. Listen, we appreciate you calling, man. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay, Tom, man, grows a lot of different kind of fruit. Matter of fact, I got a couple of different kind of figs from him, and he also showed me grafting a pear tree one time. Anyway, let's slide up to Memphis, Tennessee. Mike, how are you doing today?
Hey, man, getting rained on here today.
Good.
My question is, squash and zucchinis and stuff have petered out. What should I be planting this time of year in my vegetable container garden?
Well, it's a good question. You can still plant up until, well, really, this is sort of the last week. If you wanted to squeeze in some more summer stuff, maybe some more squash in containers, maybe some tomatoes or even peppers, if you get in Memphis this week, you still have plenty of time to harvest. We're at the beginning of the season for planting the cool season things like cabbage and broccoli and collards and kale. You can still plant those a month from now, but you can start planting some of those kind of things, carrots, beets, lettuces. As long as it's not too hot, you can grow some leafy greens, but we're sort of at the beginning of the season for those things over the next month or so. So kind of in-between stuff. But, again, if you want to set out a few flowers, some marigolds and some more squash, and give them a try.
Yeah, you're talking about from seed or from on those tomatoes? Are you talking about getting plants?
I'd set out the transplant. Tomatoes and peppers I'd set out as transplants, but the other things like squash and all, you can still set out from seed. You know, we still have as long a season between now and fall as northerners have all summer long. So we still have a good full season if you get right on it for summer stuff. But then again, you know, you can just rework your dirt and, you know, let it rest for a little bit and start planting the fall stuff in the next 2 or 3 weeks or so.
I just can't stand bare dirt.
Well, I know.
Something needs to grow.
There you go. Well, you know, if nothing else, you know, just, you know, put you some, see if you get some ryegrass seed or something growing there just to kind of grow up there and turn it into empty. You can work up potting soil even by growing some organic matter. But, you know, a few flowers, just pick something that's pretty in there for right now.
In about a month, start the fall crops?
You can start fall crops right now. You just got to watch your watering a little bit more because it is so hot.
Oh, okay. All right, man, I sure appreciate it.
Okay, Mike, appreciate your call. Thank you. And we're going to take a little break, I guess. Java, if you want to play the cheesy tune, it's not a long tune. It's more of a traveling tune because I've spent the past week on airplanes, trains, ferries, buses, foot, car, every possible kind of way. And I just
did you throw in horseback?
Didn't do any horseback. But, I mean, just about everything else, from subways and everything. You know, European travel, they got it down there. But I just thought I'd play a little quiet thing to sort of get my head wrapped around being back talking about gardening. Instead of looking at gardening, talking about gardening. So here at MPB, me and Java Chapman and other folks, we're going to take a little bit of a short break and come back. We've got the lines wide open. If you want to give me a call and talk about gardening, toll-free 1-877-MPB-RING. This is my 20th year of being on NPR. We're going to come back and talk with you about your garden right after this. Okie-dokie, folks, welcome back. Horticulturist Felder Rushing, and if you want to give us a call, it's toll-free 1-877-MPB-RING. I see where a call is starting to come in, but Java, let me throw something out at you. I said I was going to send you a picture of this bottle. I don't know what I said I was going to send you. I took so many pictures at Floriade, but I also visited in Amsterdam the oldest botanical garden in Europe. It's called Hortus Botanicus, and it was started in the 1630s. That was 100 years before we started giving plants Latin names. So I'm setting this up. You see, this is a big deal, botanical garden, right?
Yes, sir. That is a big deal.
Well, in this ancient botanic garden where they have plants from all over the world, they had a butterfly house. It's just incredible stuff. The only sculpture they have in this entire garden, the only sculpture is a huge sculpture of Magnolia grandiflora, our state flower, what's on our state flag. The only sculpture in Europe's oldest botanic garden is our magnolia flower. Ain't that something?
The mighty magnolia.
That's right. Well, I'm gonna send you a picture of it to put on our podcast for today. So look for that, man. Anyway, I was real pleased to see that. I felt real special. But they didn't do it because of Mississippi flower. They did it because it's one of the coolest flowers on earth. It actually evolved before bees and butterflies. It was evolved to be pollinated by beetles and stuff. So it's been around a long time. So anyway, let's fly down to the Gulf Coast to Bay St. Louis and talk with Vicki. Vicki, thank you for calling. What's up?
Hey, good morning. You were talking about all the bottle walls and houses. Well, not houses, but have you ever been to Supply, North Carolina, to see Mary's Gone Wild? Or have you heard of that?
No, I haven't been there, but I've not only heard about it, I've read about it, I've seen a lot of pictures of it. You know, there's so many. I'm not going to call us weirdos because I'm that way. I've got 20 bottle trees in my yard. But there's a lot of people who are really enamored of glass in the garden. But now, where is she in South Carolina? I forget the name of the town.
It's called Supply, S-U-P-P-L-Y. And the reason I was in that location, I was going to Wilmington to see Airlie Gardens. Have you seen there? Have you been there to see the big bottle house that they have there?
I wrote a book on bottle trees and other garden glass, and they have pictures. They have one a bottle house that's got a huge butterfly made out of bottles. And there's a picture that
that's sure
actually
that's
in my bottle tree.
But
it is.
This one is like a little temple almost, and they have it kind of, you can't go in right now, and it's almost in disrepair. I was there in 2017, so I can't say what shape it's in now.
But this is Wilmington, right?
That's Wilmington at Airlie Gardens.
I gave a lecture there, and I actually have a picture. It might have been around the corner from that, but it's a wall made of bottles that's about three times as tall as I am, and it's got a butterfly bigger than I am made out of bottles. I got a picture of it. I actually have a picture of that on my blog on bottle trees, fellerrushing.blog. I just put up a thing last week on bottle trees, and it's got a picture of that, and it's there at that botanic garden.
Right. It's a beautiful place. But as beautiful as it was, I loved Mary's better because she was a true folk artist. She just it stood still. She did something with it or glued it to something or stacked it on top. And she's got this round little round house with bottles in it. I'll have to email you some pictures if you haven't been there.
Yeah, do that. It's been years and years and years since I've been there, many years. It's probably been 15 years since I gave my lecture there. But do that.
If you're in that part of the country, too, in Bishopville, South Carolina, I'm sure you know about the...
I know Pearl Fryer really, really well. Pearl and I go... He actually has a flower pot made of a tire that I made for him there. Incredible topiary artist.
Right. But if you're there, go find the Bishopville. In Bishopville, there's also a button museum, and it's out in the middle of a field. And it's a metal building, and you just ask somebody, follow the signs. It is amazing, too. It's just one little guy doing his weird stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. And, it's a personality type that does things like that. The toilet paper lid, the toilet lid museum. There's a website. Whenever I go someplace new, I always go to this one website because it has a map of that state and all these little dots on there. Click on them. It's got the unusual things. It's called Roadside America, RoadsideAmerica.com. Mm-hmm. Click on Mississippi, and it'll have every weird thing you can find in Mississippi. And how to get to it, and what it's like, and reviews and stuff. Roadside America's got all those kind of things.
And one last thing, if you're in that part of the country, you've got to go to Wilson, North Carolina, and see the whirligigs. Have you seen those? Those are amazing.
No.
Google.
No, I haven't. I will. I appreciate it. There's so many fun things like that. And to me, looking for places like that takes you off the beaten path, and it's not so much there the destination, but they let you know how creative people can be with a lot of times with recycled stuff. But anyway, I appreciate that a whole bunch. Thank you, Vicki.
And Felder, I just went to RoadsideAmerica.com, and they have the website, and it's exactly as you said. It has all the things. I pulled up Mary's Gone Wild right there in Supply. North Carolina is a funky place.
sometimes click on the Mississippi thing and look at all the strange things. It doesn't have my garden on there because it doesn't meet the standards for being weird. But it's got every weird thing you can imagine in it. Anyway, and it's always fun. This is what keeps things off the beaten track. So anyway, let's slide down to Mobile and talk with Louise. Louise, how are you doing today?
Okay, very well. Thank you. How about you?
Good. So far, so good. What's up?
My daughter lives in Atlanta, and we love hibiscus. And she just sent me a picture of her hibiscus, and she's worried about it. I'm trying to explain it to you. The leaf is turning yellow, and then it has little sores on it. I kind of think it looks like monkeypox. But anyway, they're
Like they're orange colored.
Pardon me?
Are they orange colored?
No, they're like little dark circles, and the center of it is turning brown, and just in some of them, just completely dying, like it leaves a hole in it.
Yeah. You know, without seeing a picture of it, I can't be sure, but there are several, there's a bacteria, there's several fungal diseases that affect the foliage of all that whole family, from hollyhocks to cotton to hibiscus, and, you know, especially when we have a lot of rain and a lot of humidity. If a spore splashes onto a plant and it stays humid and moist, it grows into one of those circles, and in turn, it throws more spores around. Not much we can do about it except cut off the leaves that are badly infected. And if she wanted to keep it from getting worse, she'd have to spray the new leaves that don't have the spots with a fungicide. It's sort of like a protective film. It doesn't cure the disease, but keeps clean leaves from getting disease. You just have to spray an awful lot, just like with roses. If you don't spray all the time, you know, there's not much you can do except snip off the bad-looking leaves.
Okay. And just clip off the leaves, not the branches, not do a big cutback.
That's right. I mean, she can cut it back because these things bloom on new growth. She wants to cut it back. But if it's not too far progressed, just snip off the bad leaves, and, you know, you don't have to burn them or anything. Just get them away from the plant, because they splash spores from those infected leaves to uninfected leaves. So just keep an eye on that.
Wonderful. We'll do that. Thank you so much.
Okay, good luck on it. Okay, now let's slide over to Hendersonville. James, what's going on today?
Hello, how are you guys doing today? My name is James. I'm from Hendersonville. I'm living in my grandmother and grandfather's old house, Taylor. And my grandmother always had an immaculate flower garden. And I'm not going to have it until this spring, but I would like to know. I don't have a tiller, so I'd have to do it by hand. So what I was wanting to do is see if this is okay. What I was wanting to do is take off maybe an inch of soil, and that would get some of the grass and stuff away. And what do I need to do to get the soil ready? Because it's not had any flowers in it, probably about 20 years, because my grandmother's been gone that long.
Yeah, well, a couple of things. You know, you can dig it by hand. You don't really have to get rid of all that grass and stuff. And I'll tell you why, because you can scoop it out there, and it's going to have to kill you to do that. But a lot of more is just going to come back from seeds. There's just not any real good way to do that. So what I've done, and this is when I have a brand new bed. There's not much room left in my garden, but bed by bed, the way I did them, was I would dig two. I would cut straight down with my shovel. I make two cuts about as far apart as a shovel is wide, right? And then I start at one end. I would just dig down. I turn it upside down like you would a piece of cake. You slice the cake up and take each one, turn it with the icing on the bottom and the cake on the top. If you do it a shovel slice at a time, then that buries the stuff, and it actually, as it decomposes, it makes good dirt down deep. So instead of scraping
fertilizes, it off, the grass fertilizes the soil that I'm going to be putting the flowers in this spring. So that's a great idea.
Yeah, it fertilizes and improves it. But again, it's easier to do if you'll cut two lines and then dig the stuff out in between. Instead of just digging into a cake, you know, cut your two lines in it and then turn a piece. Do that a piece at a time. And then when you get that turned over, and you can do that a little at a time, find some tree leaves. Just, you know, this fall when people start putting bags of leaves out on, you know, and just cover the ground up with that stuff. Just cover it up. And over the wintertime, that will really improve your soil. So turn it upside down, add some organic matter, and you'll be well on your way.
Excellent. Thank you very much. We have tons of trees, so we can just get them right here from the front yard. So excellent.
Yeah,
thank
you
very much for your time.
If you could run your lawnmower on to take a leaf blower rake or something, just rake them, just completely cover that area up with it. I mean, for that matter, you could kill the grass and stuff right now by just laying some cardboard over it and covering it up with tree leaves. And by springtime, the grass will be dead. You could dig it all up. It's called lasagna gardening. And just cover it with cardboard, cover that up with leaves, and it'll kill all the grass beneath it, and just dig it all in together. Whole lot easier
excellent
to do stuff. It's a lot easier this time of year.
Excellent. Thank you. I hope you have a great rest of the day. Thank you for your information.
You bet, James. Thank you. And folks who think of what I am, bless your heart, James. That ain't going to be easy. But this idea of covering grass up with cardboard and then covering it up with leaves and stuff, it really, really does work. If you got a little time, it really, really works well. So we're going to take a real quick break. We've got plenty of time to take some phone calls, plenty of time. So if you want to give us a call, it's toll-free, 1-877-MPB-RING. Like Job and I were talking earlier, we're going to check in with the medical professionals about this new bacteria, the soil-borne bacteria, that causes a rare disease called melioidosis. Not anything really to be worried about, not anything to be concerned about, but something to be aware of, and because you're probably going to hear a lot about it. So we're going to keep it real. We're going to get down to the bottom line and what you can do from a practical point of view. I'm not worried about it myself because so far it's just on the coast, but I'm not going to go out and dig in bare dirt with cut-up fingers after pruning my roses. Might put some gloves on for that. Anyway, we'll be right back with more of the Gestalt Gardener right here on MPB right after this.
Hey, this is Larry Morrissey with the Mississippi Arts Commission. I'm one of the hosts of the Mississippi Arts Hour, the arts interview show on Think Radio. Each week, myself or one of my fellow hosts bring you in-depth interviews with different creative Mississippians. We talk with visual artists, musicians, writers, as well as people who help bring the arts to their communities. We hear about how each artist learned their craft and get some insight into their creative process. You can hear the Arts Hour every Sunday at 5 p.m. on Think Radio, or listen anytime by subscribing to the show through your favorite podcasting app.
Okie dokie, folks, welcome back to Horticulture's Felder Rushing. And if there's some things that you'd like to talk about, give us a call. It's toll-free 1-877-MPB-RING. I've been fielding a lot of emails and seeing a lot of concerns on the Mississippi Gardening Facebook about what to plant this time of year, what to do this time of year. And we are at the very tail end of when you can plant summer stuff like squash and set out tomato plants if you can find them, and pepper plants and all. And yeah, you can set out cool season things, collards and broccoli and cabbage and lettuce and things like that, but you need to be prepared to water. But more important, they need to be mulched. Mulch, it could be bark, it could be shredded paper, it could be leaves, anything that keeps the... It's sort of like putting an umbrella over the soil, like putting a blanket over it. It keeps the sun from heating, from overheating the soil. It keeps the soil from crusting over and drying out as quickly. And it sort of moderates it just moderates things. So if you're going to plant this time of year, work the dirt up, plant your stuff, and then as soon as they come up, cover the ground up with something like bark. Or even some pine straw. It takes a little bit more pine straw. Pine straw needs to be put on 2 or 3, 4 inches deep to really work. Bark only needs to be an inch or so deep, or a combination. But the main thing is cover the ground up to keep it cool in the daytime and moisture a little bit longer. That really does make a difference. With things like seeds, of course, lettuce and turnips and carrots, they don't like a lot of mulch. So you have to wait till they sprout before you lightly work up the dirt around them and then mulch around the plants. One of the things that I'm going to be doing in a few weeks when I get home is getting my garden ready for fall, for one thing. And that means a little bit of weeding, you know, a lot of morning glory that's come up over the summer, a lot of things like that. Most of those weeds are pretty easy to pull. But I just got a new type of hoe. It's not new. It's ancient. It looks like a hoe, but it's got a real thin blade, and I keep it sharp. Instead of chopping weeds, what you do is you pull it and you just sort of scuffle. It's like shaving the ground. Instead of chopping, it's like shaving. And if you've ever shaved your face or your legs or your underarms or whatever with a dull old razor, you know when you get a new razor how much easier it works, more efficiently. It just works better with less effort. That's what a sharp edge does to a hoe. So if you've got a hoe or a shovel, you want to get the most out of it with the least amount of effort on your end, get you a flat-bladed file, preferably one that's got a handle on it so you don't scrape your knuckles. And just every now and then stop what you're doing and just put a little sharp edge on it. And that way it just crunches, it slices so much. If you're having to chop, there's something wrong. So a sharp hoe, believe it or not, is one of the most effective, fastest ways to control weeds, and it loosens up the soil, which makes sort of like a dust mulch. So if you don't have room for let's say if you got a big garden, you don't have room for a lot of bark or pine straw or leaves as a mulch, use what's called a dust mulch. Just lightly work the ground up, just enough to scrape the weeds and provide just a little bit of loose dirt to cover up the dirt a little bit further down. A whole lot easier to go. So I feel like Java, that I'm sometimes preaching to the choir, but a lot of people know that, you know, the old things still work.
And I believe this is probably the type of advice that goes around the Facebook, the Mississippi Gardening Facebook page, you know, because you got the people that come in and I mean, you, like you say, you preach it to the choir, but same.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so, sometimes somebody say, you know, I've got this problem, and I say, well, I would do this and this and this, and somebody comes back and says, Felder, you don't have to do any of that stuff. Just do this. You know, trying to keep it real. So sometimes that the scientific community, the horticulture community, the production-oriented, sales-oriented community, sometimes has different approach towards perfection than what I call garden variety gardeners. They just want to get the job done. So one of my big jobs is to take sometimes complex things, even to me, and break them down into plain English. You know, here's what Mama would have done. Here's what Aunt Mamie would have done. And they didn't do any of that horticulture. It's like pruning roses. They say prune roses above an outward-facing five-leaflet leaf. You can prune roses with cherry bombs, and they'll still bloom. So somewhere in between what Aunt Mamie did out of just not knowing any better, what a horticulturist or rose society person would do, somewhere in between is going to be about right. So, yeah.
Well, Felder, we're pulling up our last call, our call screen to Charles, the intern. He's in there queuing them up. But I want to say this, RoadsideAmerica.com, I want to say thank you for this. Because this,
you didn't know about that?
I did not know about any of this. And it has hit me to some different things around the state. Like, I didn't know IUCA is the home of the world's largest apron museum. You have the 35-foot chair in Gulfport, the big rocking chair, and then something even more crazy in Baxterville, they have atomic bombs were exploded there in 1964, 1966 as part of Project Dribble, and they have a monument. You know, as like you say, just something to see that's off the beaten path. Like, who knew about some of these things?
Yeah, and, you know, right at the very bottom of the Delta on Highway 61 is a little town called Onward. Onward, it's just a store. But that's where Teddy Roosevelt went on a bear hunt, and he refused to kill a bear that was chained up. And so that's where the teddy bear came from, Onward, Mississippi.
Yeah. Now let's go to this last call. We got Joey in Newton County going to help us end the show.
Hey, Zoe, what's up?
I actually wasn't listening to the program, but somebody told me that there was a question about a pest attacking hibiscus.
Yeah.
A few minutes ago. I have a good idea what it is. It's probably sawflies. Sawflies, they're not flies. They're related to bees and wasps. If the person
right.
will check the underside of the leaves, they may find the villain, the actual thing, that the sawflies themselves don't eat the leaves, it's the grub, the larva.
But these holes in the leaves?
Yeah, it's a little maggot-type thing. I could send you some, I have even photographed the things where they're kind of small.
I'm familiar with sawflies. It did not occur to me. This is what makes them look lacy leaf.
Yes, yes. They're one of the, their favorite food is apparently hibiscus. Native, non-native, you name it, they like it.
Yeah, somebody said, you know, they're really hard to control, too. So what I suggest is just take your glasses off and call it lace leaf hibiscus and go with the flow.
And that's Joe McGee. Thank you, Joe. Joe, he's a frequent contributor on Creature Comforts, and he was actually on the show just yesterday. Joe knows just about everything, man.
Yeah, and, you know, I didn't think about sawflies. I was picturing round circles instead of just a skeletonized leaf. But anyway, living and learning, you know. I've written 30-something books. I know some stuff, but there's a lot of stuff I just don't know. And together, we're going to figure it out. We're going to learn stuff together. And I'm all right with that. That's one of my hallmarks, is loving to learn. And loving to share. And that's what we do on MPB is we learn stuff, we share, we kick around ideas. And if we don't know something, we'll find it out. We'll figure it out. We're not going to be a bunch of know-it-alls here. And so garden variety gardeners, horticulturists, people are just dirt gardeners. We're going to get together and find common ground. Hey, if you get a chance, take a kid to a farmer's market this weekend. There's lots of cool stuff going on there, and they can talk to people who actually